Director of Clinical Research, Division of Cardiology. There's a whole lot of background, which is on the sheets that you got, and I'm not going to go through all that. But for over 23 years, his lab has been using heart tissue for research that comes from people like ourselves or from those hearts that they couldn't use. And as a result, both past and present studies are designed to identify mechanisms of heart failure and develop new treatment strategies. And that's what he's going to be talking about today. So with that, I will shut up and pass it over to Ken.
So I'll start by saying I'm grateful for all of you, of course, right? And I'll start on a multiple levels. First of all, I'm grateful to have a fresh chance to be inspired by your stories. And I appreciate hearing them and the things that mean the most to you. I do appreciate all that you have done for me, and I'll talk about that, right? That pretty much everybody in this room, I think, has donated their heart to our tissue bank, or very close to everybody. And I guess this is part of my reporting about what have we been doing with it. This won't be a comprehensive view, but it'll be a representative view. We're doing things with each and every heart, and some things we do when it first comes out, and many things we do months or years later when somebody in our lab or some other lab wants to leverage this valuable resource to answer a question. And we try to be very responsible stewards of what you've given us, and I'm very thankful for that. I'm thankful to be in a job that allows me to do the stuff I do, whether it's the human part of meeting all of you or the science geeky part that I'll tell you about. And so I do have a lot to be thankful for, and I'm happy to be here. My mission is to try to help alleviate burdens associated with heart failure, whether it's individual patients' burdens or societal burdens that are highlighted here. It's a big-time problem, and all of you know it in a more personal way even than most. In people who are trying to make a difference, we think about this business of translational research. We're in the Smilo Translational Research Center, and people make diagrams like this. This isn't mine. To try to highlight what the problem is. And you see this, the top of the slide talks about between T0, this basic research that we do in laboratories on animal models or isolated cells, and then suddenly it becomes T1, translation to human. And this kind of diagram that makes it sound like it's just so easy is really a terrible oversimplification about how hard it is to get a concept from cells or animals into human beings. And what we have found is studying the failing hearts or the controls from organ donors whose families have donated their hearts is actually one of the mechanisms to get across what seems like a very little step here between T0 and T1. It's actually a chasm. I was at the American Heart Association meeting with Enzo Mariel Jessup, who's now working for an institute, a foundation, that's trying to help accelerate this sort of process. And she said, what she's learned is it's not a valley of death, it's a canyon. It's 20 valleys of death between how many things that look promising never make it to patients. And so having an additional approach to help bridge that gap is something we desperately need. And I have found, with some examples I'll show you, that human tissues provide an opportunity in that regard. So, the first one I'm going to start with is an old story. It's okay, though, because people like Mr. Bullock and others who have been transplanted a long time ago contributed to this older story, namely this business about can hearts recover, right? So when people first started, and Mr. Vito mentioned about the VADs, and they're imperfect, but they're also, they do help bridge people to transplant, and many people, it's their long-term therapy, but they have another role. They're also a bridge to recovery in certain patients, where people get on VADs and then they get off VADs. And they're also a laboratory to study the plasticity of the heart. And that's how we began using them, and that led to the bridge to recovery usage. Let me tell you about how that story went. So the question was, do severely failing hearts recover? We saw that people were getting heart support devices like shown in this cartoon. This is the old time HeartMate One device. And it was a big, clunky device that tended to wear out after a number of years and very imperfect. But what it did do is unload the heart, and it helped us use medicines that people couldn't tolerate when they weren't on the device. And it gave us a chance to see, okay, it gives us two pieces of tissue, right? Because when they put the device in, a little core of tissue comes out here to let the heart be drained by the device. And then when the patient gets transplanted, the rest of the heart comes out. And we get a chance to study two decent-sized pieces of human heart tissue at two different points in time. And that pretty much never happens anywhere else in medicine. So it gave us a unique window into the biology of the heart. And we wondered about whether it could show us what sort of changes are occurring when the heart gets unloaded and when they get put on all the right medicines. And so before I go into that story, I want to mention that doing heart tissue research is hard because outside of the transplant situation, or even inside the transplant situation, there's technical challenges. So the heart, which is sustaining us all the time, has the highest metabolic activity of any organ in the body. And even 10 minutes of what we call warm ischemia, unprotected time, where it sort of beats itself till it fails, it destroys the heart tissue in a way that makes the research uninterpretable. So we have collaboration from our surgeons who use all these cardioprotective solutions when we get before we get the hearts in the research, and so I'm grateful for them as well, that people like Dr. Acker, Dr. Jeevanandan back at Temple, and countless others have been collaborators in our research to help us have successful, technically good heart tissue to work with. And so we've learned the tricks of the trade to make the heart tissue interpretable and preserved so that we can get useful information. And in other situations, like heart biopsies, you know, we got these tiny pieces of tissue, you know, barely bigger than a pinhead, whereas in transplant or VAT inserts, we get much bigger pieces of tissue and can get a lot more information from them. It takes a lot of dedication. It mentions here that heart tissues are performed at night. So it's not just me, but it's a whole lab full of people who are studying these hearts and getting out of bed in the middle of the night to study them. And it takes a very great deal of dedication and number of people to generate research out of the transplants that happen. So we have learned a lot of different approaches. I'm going to highlight a few of these to get the most out of the most information out of hearts that can help teach us about the mechanisms of heart failure and opportunities for new therapies. So one of the things we've done most of the time in the 23, 24 years I've been doing this is we have taken the hearts that we get from the operating room, and we do, first of all, we protect them. That's what I was mentioning. They get this same protection as if they were having a bypass surgery or a valve surgery, because otherwise you end up with garbage. Then we take a small area of heart tissue, we get a catheter into an artery in that small area, and we perfuse it with enzymes that help digest out the individual muscle cells so we can study them individually. We do other things with the heart tissue. Sometimes we study strips of muscle, sometimes we study pieces that we put in the freezer and come back to later. But these isolated myocyte studies in human hearts are pretty unique. There are only a handful of labs in the country or world that actually do these types of things. It takes a lot of dedication and practice and technical expertise, but it provides us a way to do carefully controlled studies of what's going on in the individual muscle cells that make up the heart. Just as a fun fact, muscle cells are, you know, far less than a millimeter big, you know, really a tenth of a millimeter long, and yet there's 7 billion of them in the human heart. So we're just studying a sample of them. So one of the reasons why we had to study this heart recovery question at the individual cell level is that when a heart's on a support device, its ejection fraction, or things that you folks are used to hearing about, measures of heart function, are unreliable because the amount of blood filling the heart and the amount of work it has to do against the blood pressure is very much altered by that, and we couldn't really measure it in a fair way when the VAD was still in place. So what we did is we took the cells from the core of tissue, and we took the cells from the explanted heart months later, and we compared how they work in vitro. And this was an important result. This is almost a 20-year-old study now. This got a lot of press and attention at the time. It's my most cited paper, probably been cited by another 500 articles. And what it showed is that when you take an individual muscle cell from an organ donor, so what this is the length of the cell being tracked as time. So this is cell length on the vertical axis and time on the x-axis. And what you see is that the cell is, when it's stimulated, is getting shorter, right? It contracts, just like our whole heart muscle contracts. And then it relaxes, and it happens very fast. And it shortens and relengthens very quickly. But in heart failure, it shortens more slowly, it doesn't shorten as much, and it relengthens more slowly. And after a period of LVAD support, we see something in between. And I'm not going to show you all the different varieties of that finding, but pretty much every feature of the severely failing heart shows a similar type of thing. It looks way worse than the non-failing heart, not surprisingly, and that after a period of months of LVAD support, it gets partially better. Very few times does it get 100% better, but we've studied the electrical signals, the connective tissue in the heart. We've studied the calcium management of heart cells. We've studied all the different parts that are part of normal cardiac physiology. They all are messed up in severely failing hearts for patients who need transplants, and nearly all of them migrate towards an improvement after a period of months of LVAD support. And that's really was only, that insight was both that it's improvement and that it's not complete improvement has only been energized by, you know, the tissues that folks like you have donated to programs like ours. And so this is the other things I mentioned, right? That there's decreased heart muscle, right? Heart cells are bigger in people with heart failing hearts or long-standing hypertension or other conditions like that. And they regress towards a more normal size after a period of heart support. They contract better. Their electrical abnormalities get at least partially improved. Their responses to things like adrenaline and increased heart rate, which is part of what needs to happen when we're to exercise well, are improved. And the inflammation in the heart also goes down. So all of these things we learn from these human heart tissues, but I won't show you data for them. And the whole point of this is not just to say, hey, we've got a paper published and people cited and this thing, cool. It's to say, well, what do we do with that insight, right? Because I said that the purpose of this talk is as a tool for translational research. So something that was unheard of before started to get a little wind in its sails, this idea maybe these hearts that are on that support, if we start seeing evidence that they're improving before we get the individual muscle cells out of them, maybe we can try to explant the VADs and see if some people will recover. Because as great as the transplant is, it would be really nice to have a stable, manageable, mildly dinged heart rather than a transplant. As many people feel that way. So what we learned from the studies we did is that there were certain hearts that were more likely to show recovery or a greater degree of recovery. People from younger people, let's say under 60, people from who had non-ischemic cardiomyopathy rather than severe coronary artery disease that had caused a lot of heart attacks, and a few other factors. So we designed a clinical trial. This was mostly led by a woman named Emma Burks at the University of Kentucky, Dr. Rami, and several other prominent, you know, VAD emphasizing clinicians and investigators led this trial, but we're part of it, I'm part of it too. That we recruited the right kind of patients getting support, and we designed a protocol where everyone would get the medicines we know that help weak hearts do better, where everyone would get it pretty aggressively, and that we would look for signs of recovery and try to act on them and consider explanting the VAD in the people who showed those signs. And that included optimization of loading conditions and treating medical aggressive medical therapy and doing a series of echocardiograms. And so that trial is recently finished on loading. But the bottom line of it is about 44% of patients appear to be showing enough recovery to get their VADs explanted, and then the VADs, the patients are staying explanted for the most part. And that's pretty good. It doesn't mean that VADs are going to take away and get rid of the heart failure epidemic. It means that if you have a certain type of patient with a certain type of aggressive treatment and careful attention, you'll notice some sufficient recovery in a subset of the patients, but not a 1% subset, you know, a third or more that might enable them to not need a transplant. But this all began by the hearts you folks donated that we had a chance to study in greater depth. So, you know, its conclusions from the study, this will be presented at the International Society of Heart and Lung Transplant meeting in the spring. That in selected patients with chronic non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, aggressive drug therapy, optimal unloading, and regular testing of underlying function results in significant improvement in heart function, and that a high rate of explantation, we're not really calling it resolution of heart failure, they still have failing hearts, they still have cardiomyopathies. We're calling it sort of remission, like even cancer patients, they don't really always get cured, but they're in disease-free remission. We have an ability in many of these patients to have a period of remission from their heart failure. And that now it's all six of our centers that are part of this trial have successfully done this, so it doesn't look like it's some idiosyncrasy of one center being great at this and nobody else can replicate it. And like everything else, it's a partial answer, right? We have to follow people longer. Maybe they're going to go back into heart failure that needs a VAD or a transplant. When we wait 4 or 5 years, we heard about people here who make 5 years, 20 years, 17 years. So this is the middle of the journey, not the end of the journey. Okay, so that's one story. I'm happy to pause there for questions if anybody has any. Yeah.
I imagine I'm assuming or imagining that patients in the situation of explaining may have a little better opportunity to either get rid of or get in control of the antibodies that they've been introduced to by blood products that were needed to prevent them.
We haven't studied as much about that. It may be particularly attractive for people who do have a lot of antibodies because it's hard to match them and avoid rejection. And so if they have features that would make them respond in a way to the prolonged unloading and aggressive medical therapy with the VAD support, it might be particularly attractive to somebody who has lots of antibodies and is hard to match for a transplant. I wouldn't say that the process that we're doing is debulking the antibodies. So,
what was the average time needed to see enough improvement?
Months. And in this trial, close to a year. And in the cell studies, when we got a heart that happened to have been transplanted within a month or so, after, one month or 6 weeks, we didn't see much of the recovery. So even in the cell, at the cellular level, it takes a few months. And at the whole patient level, probably even longer. And of course, you want to use some of that time to do the gradual reloading or testing, stress testing, and things like that, to really reassure yourself that this bold move of explanting the device is really reasonable. And that's so that adds a few more months too, that you're really trying to build up your own confidence that this is reasonable.
Dr. McCullis, why do you believe that the LVAD facilitates the possibility of explanting?
I think that's a really good question, right? So our current understanding about heart failure progression in general, emphasizes that certain things like abnormal loading conditions when you have a very leaky valve or when you have long-standing hypertension, that these things weaken the heart muscle when relentlessly applied to it, right? If we all do some vigorous exercise, our blood pressure spikes up and comes down, that's not the same thing. But if we have hypertension that's unchecked, high arterial resistance that's unchecked with medications, that takes its toll on the heart. And there's no question that these support devices unload that mechanical burden on the heart. In addition, we know that there's certain hormonal things, or what we call neuromodal activation, relentless adrenaline stimulation, or other peptide hormones that we know have their own toll on the heart over time. So that's why I think a big part of this is that the device provides the stability and the unloading and the opportunity to introduce fairly aggressive doses of medications that all of the patients in the room are already on to get their benefits. I say that that's our current standard because there's other molecular features of heart failure that we're actually learning about and presented in another part of this that may provide new opportunities for treatment. So maybe we can do even better if we start targeting medicines that our current bag of medications doesn't target. So that's another part of this. I think it's alleviating the overload, it's allowing people to tolerate medicines that help kind of across the board, and that's what we're doing now. But I think the future is, like I said, it's kind of the middle of the story. We'll learn to target other medications with the stability provided by the VAD that might even result in higher levels of success. That's our goal anyway. Yeah.
Is it more possible to explant someone with a VAD who may be suffering viral cardiomyopathy because a lot of them are younger?
Yeah, I think so. I think that there are certain, I think no heart that's been severely failing really gets back to normal if you look hard enough. But I think some get more predictably and more closely back to normal, or nearly normal. And those acute viral myocarditis are some of our explants even before this trial. In fact, we don't even count them in this trial. So people who really had an acute, so I should mention that, but the restage inclusion criteria demanded people who had at least 6 months of heart failure. They really had, it came fast, it went fast. We don't need a heart support device, so we don't need this trial to prove that those sometimes happen.
Yeah, I was thinking more of one of your patients at Temple.
Yeah. Right. No, so the ones that have longer, right. Viral myocarditis and it's the inflammation state settles down, but they're still left very compromised. That kind of patient would still be suitable for this, and we think it would help. Yeah.
Sometimes you decide to put LVAD on the right side, sometimes on the left side. How do you decide that, whether to put on both sides or only on one side?
It's a lot of clinical decision making about measures with echo or other techniques of how sick the right side is. There's hardly anybody who's getting right side only. It's either whether it's LV or biventricular support. The LV support usually gives a fair amount of help to the RV, and most of the time it's enough, but sometimes it's not. In the restage study, the only people who are eligible are the LV only support. Great questions. Let me go on to another mini story. So these are the people to thank, right? They're people, some of the names are people who were from Temple when that work was started. The other people are people who have been involved in the clinical trial that's been part of translating it. Another thing, right, in looking for mechanisms that might further improve our armamentarium of things that might help people with heart failure, there is been 30 years of transgenic mouse studies where we've been using mouse models of human disease, and they have both shortcomings and upsides for understanding how different mechanisms contribute to weakening of the heart muscle or enlargement of the heart. And a lot of the things that we get asked to share tissue for are people who don't have access to human tissue. They're mostly mouse heart failure investigators or mouse myocardiobiology investigators. And they want to know, is what I'm doing relevant to people who have heart failure? They don't have the privileged access that I have. All this heart tissue. So they come to me by email or meetings. I got 3 different requests at the American Heart Association meeting earlier this week to share tissue to answer people's questions about whether there's a connection between what they're observing in rodents and what we find here. So let me share one story on this front. This is, I'm not dumbing this down, this is a pretty complicated scenario, but it also has a pretty good video that helps you understand it. So I told you that a big part of what we do is we start with protecting the heart, we get individual muscle cells We study them like we did for those LVAD studies, and then we can do some other manipulations. We can actually sometimes save them in the lab for a few days while we can manipulate individual molecules. This is a story that will involve that, so we use this part of our armamentarium and so on. Okay, so an individual muscle cell is rod-shaped, like my finger here. If you imagine the rod between these two fingers, it's shortening with every stimulation with an electrical beat. So sometimes it's a pacemaker that makes the whole heart beat, sometimes it's the body's biological pacemaker, the SA node, that starts the electrical beat. Sometimes with a cell in a dish, you need to give it an external electric field to make the cell contract. Those profiles that I showed you, where the cell was shortening and relengthening, those are measuring the endpoints of a given cell and watching it shorten and relengthen. Okay, so this, I'm going to show you some pictures of an intracellular structure called a microtubule that we know is part of the what we call the cytoskeleton, so the cell's skeleton, scaffold that all the other proteins are connected to in the heart. And microtubules are one part of that cytoskeleton. And this is a confocal, fairly advanced microscope. New as of 20 years ago. To get pictures of microtubules, you see them here. There's some newer microscopes that can, the Ariescan microscope that one of my collaborators in the Department of Physiology has, that clearly sharpen these pictures up and allow us to see them much more clearly, even in cells that are alive with special live cell stains. And with some approaches, you can actually watch how these tubules that run the length of all the cell, of each individual cell from end plate to end plate, you can actually watch how they move during the heartbeat. So that's what this video is going to show. So if we play this, we see that they're sort of buckling. And they're acting like rebars or struts that are keeping the structure of the heart, just like our skeleton keeps the structure of our bodies without some floppy mass on the ground. This seems like it pushes out on the end plates. And if you take the video at higher speed and then slow it down, which I think the next slide, you see this even better. So this is happening within the cell to the cell's cytoskeleton, cell skeleton, each and every beat of our lives times 7 billion heart muscle cells. Every beat, there's this buckling of the cytoskeleton and elongation of the cell. This isn't the part that's making it contract. This is sort of, if anything, it looks like it's resisting its contraction. But it's providing a certain structure. And it may be part of how it relengthens after the shortening phase. Okay? So my collaborator, Ben Prosser, of the Department of Physiology, studies microtubules a lot and knows their biology a lot. And one of the things that he found and learned about is that you can understand the role of these microtubules and what they're doing to the shortening by not, you can either kind of degrade the whole network of them that you see here with a medicine like colchicine. Colchicine is used for gout. A lot of people in here probably had gout. But the doses of colchicine you need to disrupt the microtubules is much higher than people can tolerate. Even a little too much gout in people, a little too much colchicine in people gives them diarrhea, whereas we're using 100 times more in these studies. But if you use 100 times more colchicine, you actually disrupt the microtubules, and you can see some effects of that. See, how much were they resisting contraction? There's also another manipulation that's a little more subtle, where you can change one amino acid at the end of the at the end of the tubulin, and that affects how much they're buckled. And so that's called tyrosination or deterosination. And so I'm going to make this part a little superficial here, but that buckling that you saw in the video can be sort of quantitative. How many buckles are there per micron? And how many, what's their wavelength, as shown here? What's their amplitude? And we can generate some quantitative features. And what we found is that if you give a medication, tubulin tyrosinate ligase, you overexpress it with a gene therapy in cells, you can actually find that the cells shorten more. This is the same kind of thing you just saw with the VAD support. Now you just give a gene therapy or a medication, PTL, that's down here, that makes the microtubules buckle less or less frequently, and you get enhanced shortening. So this is a new mechanism of trying to enhance heart function that was underappreciated until about 2 years ago or a year and a half ago, and Ben and I published a study. But it was all in rats. So it looks like that if you cause a little less microtubule buckling, you get a little less resistance to contraction, and the same stimulation results in a stronger contraction. But so what? You know, that's a rat study. What's happening in failing humans? And what's happening in non-failing humans? And so we began by giving Ben some tissue from donor hearts and people who had donor hearts and had left ventricular hypertrophy, and people like you in the room who donated hearts and had stuff in our freezer. And we said, how much of this deterosinated tubulin, the one that's associated with stiffer microtubules, is present? And what we saw, that the stiffer form, the deterosinated form, was much greater in those that had disease compared to those who didn't have disease. And we sort of added that up in lots of cells. We found, again, this deterosinated form, the one that's the stiff form of tubulin, was much greater in dilated cardiomyopathy, in ischemic cardiomyopathy, in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and after LVAD support, remember I said almost everything gets a little better during LVAD support. The red bars do come down, not quite to the normal level, but towards the normal level after LVAD support. So this is yet another feature of the failing heart that seems to migrate towards improvement. Some of the interesting ones were the hypertrophic cardiomyopathies, because the people who had hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with low ejection fractions, right, ejection fraction low is here, they had the most deterosination, most of the stiff form, where those who got transplanted with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy but still had preserved ejection fraction, they didn't. So this made us really believe that something's going on here, that this really may be affecting in vivo function, because there was this correlation between something we're looking at the subcellular level and their ejection fraction at the whole fluid level. Okay, so Dr. Prosser in physiology, he's a physiologist, he's a PhD scientist, and before the data on here, the stuff we did out of our freezer, he was figuring he's going to make some kind of mouse model of heart failure or hypertrophy, will cause hypotension or myocardial infarction or something in some poor mouse or rat, and we'll figure out what the disease relevance of this in terms of function is. But when he saw this data and knew that we can get isolated human cells from freshly donated hearts to us, we decided that the best model to explore this and the best model of heart failure is people's heart failure, not rats' heart failure or mouse heart failure. And so what we've been doing over the past year is studies in isolated human cardiac myocytes from explanted hearts, from patients with dilated cardiomyopathy, as shown here. Lots of cells studied from each heart. We're getting much better at this. We can study dozens from a single heart. And what we find is that same thing, that when you give either colchicine or this PTL, the drug that makes more tyrosinase, more of the less stiff form, that the cells beat more strongly. So now we found this, and that compared to non-failing human hearts, in non-failing human hearts, the impact of the colchicine or the drug that affects tyrosination is low. But in failing hearts, where there's more of this abnormally stiff form, you get a bigger bang for the same dose of the drug. And then we even did gene therapy. So this is isolated human heart muscle cells. This is what they look like. This is a single human cardiac myocyte. This is 1, 2, 3 here. And we actually have learned to keep them in culture for several days, long enough to infect them with a virus, that same TTL molecule that overexpresses the enzyme that helps make less of the stiff form. And what we found here is that also dramatically improved the shortening. So now we've translated this from just studies from the freezer into studies from freshly isolated human myocytes. And we're pretty excited about this maybe being, and we know that it's relevant to human beings, and their function, because we've used human myocytes rather than rodent myocytes to explore the disease. And so we have a couple drug companies interested in continuing to fund the work to extend this up to a higher level and to find out if we have a new medication to help augment heart function or to help mitigate one of the problems that's associated with more advanced heart failure. Things like, as our hearts are stiffening, one part of the stiffening is inside the cells themselves, and that's leading to a resistance to contraction. So, long way to go. This isn't even at the middle of the story. This is at the end of the beginning. But it's teaching us about cell biology that's relevant to human hearts and human heart failure. It's teaching us that we ought to pay a little more attention to this cytoskeleton because it may provide an avenue to develop some new therapies. We have a long way to go for those new therapies, but at least we know they would be relevant to human heart failure because the only heart failure we study them in is from human heart muscle cells, from failing hearts. And we'll have to let the story play out. And again, the people to thank for this are the funding for my lab and Dr. Prosser's lab. Merck has supported some of this, and Ben Prosser and people in his lab have been a big part of this. I guess since I mentioned about taking rodent studies and extending them to humans, the eight or so citations listed here are just from the past few years mostly. They're really in the top journals, Cell, Science, Nature, JCI. These are the best journals in our field. They're, adding human to rodent studies to show that they really matter to human biology and human cardiac biology really makes our field care. And it really, it's much harder to get into these journals and to make a splash without the human tissue relevance. And again, I thank you all for that because it's a big part of helping a lot of investigators that you'll never meet get their paper in better journals, get access to bigger audiences, and the attention that'll help support their research programs. And we've one of the things, those of you who donated tissues, is that we're allowed to share it with other investigators as long as we keep your identity confidential. So that they can learn and extend our reach. And I think that's really been an important contribution. In this case, I highlighted work from another Penn investigator, but most of these other things are from non-Penn investigators who have benefited from what you've been generous enough to share with us. I want to show one other thing. So, I started to show that we can manipulate cells with drugs, freshly isolate cells with drugs, or even with viruses and get a few days of we've actually started doing another sort of study. It's not started anymore, we've been doing it for about 6 years, where we actually manufacture heart muscle tissues from stem cells that we get from patient donors. So patient donors, especially those that have a genetic condition that might cause dilated cardiomyopathy or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, usually harbor a mutation that sometimes gets diagnosed before the people donate their heart to us, and sometimes after. And we, as a field, are trying to understand, how does that mutation, we know it's associated with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or dilated, but how does that work? What do they screw up in the cell that over a period of time makes the heart either weak or too thick or whatever the mutation causes? And so we've been studying that by getting isolated stem cells from people's hearts, turning them into myocytes, which is nowadays possible, and then making little mini heart tissues that we can use to model disease. I'm going to keep this one short. One of the first things that's easiest to do with these types of studies is to study drug toxicity. We know a lot of new cancer therapies make people's hearts weak or can make people's heart weak. One of them is a drug called sunitinib, part of a bigger family of VEGF inhibitors or things that block blood vessel formation that help keep tumors alive. And so they're really effective cancer treatment drugs, but we know they have some off-target effect on cardiotoxicity. And one of the things we learned with this drug, sunitinib, is that almost everybody who gets the heart toxicity has hypertension too. And we had a question, does the hypertension increase the toxicity of the drug, or does it just unmask it? Because we already answered a question earlier that says hypertension is one of those burdens that can make hearts fail over time. But here it's failing in a very short period of time. So we want to study that better. So one of the nice things about using these engineered heart tissues, I'll make it short, is that you can make tissues from scratch. And so imagine you put a bunch of cells in a dish, and they have these silicone features, these two little posts with a knobby top. And we put the cells in there, and we let them loose. And what we see is that they form into little tissues, as I hope we'll show here. So this is a time-lapse photography of a bird's eye view over here, and a side view here. And if you put even fibroblasts, which are non-contractile cells, on top of this, they form into a little tissue, and they sort of latch on to those posts and those knobs at the top. And they generate tension. They start pulling them in more. And we're measuring the tension here and the tissue formation. So this is, since this is done with just fibroblasts, this is like a little tendon forming in the dish. But of course, it's more interesting to start doing this with heart muscle cells. When we put rat heart muscle cells in the dish, they turn into little beating muscle strips like this. And the amount that the posts are moving inward, with a little math, can give you information about how much force that little muscle strip that you just made from scratch is generating. And so this is its diastolic tension, resting tension, and this is its systolic tension when it pulls in on those posts. So now we have a little model of sort of made from scratch heart muscle that we can make with either rat cells or, more interestingly, human cells. And it's most interesting when we do it with human cells that have a genetic mutation that we might want to study a little more carefully and understand how does it affect contractility, how does it affect heart growth. This is another one of those stories that's at the beginning or the end of the beginning. We have a long way to go to do this, but it's, again, inspired by the patients that we see. It's inspired and enabled by the tissues they give us. We have goals of taking heart cells that folks like you give us and studying them freshly, and then making mimics of them with the stem cell technology and the tissue engineering study and see if we see the same defects. Because ultimately, that's the best opportunity to make a new model, is compare it to the real thing and then see if your model is getting anywhere near what came out of the human being with it. And we'll be one of the only places around who can do that, because we have the ability to do both the tissue engineering, which several labs have, and the fresh human myocyte work, which very few labs have. In the case of the drug toxicity, we found that we can produce a model of toxicity in these heart muscle, in these heart tissue models, right? So here we give the drug sunitinib. We find activation of a cell death pathway pretty reliably. We find that that cell death pathway activation peaks at 8 hours, that the more you give of the drug, the worse the activation of the cell death pathway happens, that the spontaneous beating rate of the tissues goes down, the force they generate goes down, their stiffness goes down. So we have toxicity in the dish. And then we did our question. What happens if you increase the stiffness of those two posts that it's mounted on? Because that's like the in vitro version, in the lab version of hypertension. Mm. If you make stiffer posts and they have to pull against a harder, a stiffer post, that is like a little microtissue facing hypertension or aortic stenosis. And if you make those posts a little softer and more flexible, then it's like not having hypertension. And what we found with either rat tissues is if you do it on soft pillars, the toxicity is a little greater. And in human cells, as in blue, the difference between the soft pillars and the stiff pillars is even greater. So this, I think, is clinically relevant. It means the same exact dose is more toxic if you have increased resistance that the heart has to pump against, and that's dose-dependent toxicity, and it's stiffness-dependent toxicity. And this increased stiffness toxicity, or increased toxicity with increased stiffness or resistance to contraction, provides a rationale for much more aggressive antihypertensive therapy in people getting ischemic therapy. And I can tell you, myself and another investigator here, Dr. Key, are actively in the midst of writing a grant on this topic to to do a clinical trial to find out whether aggressive hypertension recommendations that were just reinforced at the American Heart Association meeting should be applied specifically to cancer patients, which are usually excluded from all these trials. They may be the people who need more aggressive blood pressure reduction more than anyone, at least with this family of chemotherapies. So again, three exemplars of what we do with your tissue, why we do it, and the potential translational insights. In each of the cases, our goal isn't just to get papers published and learn about biology in a dish. My goal, anyway, is to try to relate it to things that are inspired by our patient-related dilemmas. And so these are the people who helped with this part of the study, the tissue engineering work, and the study of the cancer therapy toxicity. And so let me just finish with a summary. Why do we like doing the tissue research? Because it's always clinically relevant. It came from our patients or our donors. It realistically reflects the variability. All of you know we are not mice. We are much more variable than a colony of inbred mice. And so sometimes we find things in mouse studies that don't translate because there's not enough background noise to separate important things from unimportant things. The variability of human beings and human heart failure is a challenge, but if you find something big that rises above that variability, it's usually something important. Sometimes it's inspired by what we see at the bedside, like, wow, look like the ejection fraction is going up in that patient with not bad, or allows careful in vitro studies that we can't always get, like in a bad-supported patient. It helps validate animal models. Animal models have a place in science and in heart failure research, but you're more excited about one that seems to correlate really well with human research or human tissue research than you are about one that doesn't correlate. And I haven't presented those stories, but there's several that didn't translate to humans very well. And so it also gives us a chance to discover new things about human hearts that we had no idea about. So I'll stop there. Again, thank you all for both your attention and for your inspiration and for your contributions to our research program. We're really very grateful.
Thank you. We have any further questions before? We have some more questions for Dr. Marlies.
Doctor, how long can you use a donated heart? For instance, we have familial hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. So my cousin and I were both transplanted within 8 days of each other here. Mm-hmm. How long do
so
you utilize?
So it depends on what types of studies we have in mind, right? So for the fresh myocyte studies, hours. You know, after 8 or 9 hours, they're not happy. But then if you put them in culture, we're actually getting better at keeping them in culture for 96 hours or 4 or 5, 6 days. And then you can do these viral manipulations. So the answer, that's a moving target. The standard answer when we're doing those LVAD studies was the first answer, 6 or 8 hours. We've actually just got a new high throughput microscope so we can study more cells in those 6 or 8 hours. But the being able to culture them and keep them rod shaped and looking like freshly isolated myocytes in culture is progress we've made in the past year or two, and that will probably extend hours into days. And then of course there's that iPS cell derivation. And that is a way that we can make new cells anytime we want and do more experiments as the technology or our inquisitiveness guides us to. On the other hand, these iPS derived or these, you know, stem cell derived cardiac myocytes are immature because we're building them from scratch. And that's why it's really important to validate against the original cell type to say, just how immature are they? How reliable or unreliable are they? So this is, again, like I said, a part of the story that's at the beginning, the end of the beginning rather than, but a lot of people are working with these stem cells that we grow up out of donated blood or donated skin tissue, but we really have to have a cold, hard look at them and say, are they really going to give us relevant signals or are they just too embryonic or fetal to be relevant to the adult human heart that we want them to be. We think we'll get there, but we think the comparison between the real thing, the freshly isolated ones, and the manufactured ones is a really important comparison so that we don't kid ourselves.
So if you use it as a fresh heart to experiment on, are you then able to freeze?
You can freeze the cells, but the types of things you can do with them after freezing are diminished. You can't study their contraction anymore. The freezing and the thawing screws that up. You can study their molecular constituents and even their structure. So that it depends on your question, what part of cell biology or structure you're trying to study. For some things, you can do it really well on frozen things, and for other things, you can't.
So once you would use it fresh, would you freeze that heart and then utilize it in other places
that's what we do. So many of our studies, again, we do as much as we can in that first night, and then we culture some, and then we save a whole lot in the freezer for studies to be named later or follow-ups to the observations we make in the studies we do in the middle of the night. Great question. Yeah.
Doctor, you mentioned that a lot of the research is being done with hearts that are in a mouse. I always thought that a pig heart was the closest to a human. Why aren't they using those?
It's just expensive. It's really, the facilities to house them, to raise them, to feed them. So it is more relevant. And even dog studies, cat studies, that mice, rodents are not the closest to humans at all. But for various reasons, resource utilization, sometimes ethical issues, whatever, we don't. There's just not nearly as much biological or biomedical research done with larger animals, even though they are more relevant. And that's why people are desperate to find models that will guide us in the right way.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a crazy question. I donated my heart. Mm-hmm. What if I had to ask the doc to put it in a jar? I want to take it home. I've asked that before, but it's been so long.
Yeah, the pathologists are not so keen on that. I think if you really insisted, you could probably get the chance to do it. Most of the time, we try to convince people that how would we snap a picture of your heart and give that to the other. We've done, Ken B., who's my main lab tech fetcher in the middle of the night, isolating cells, has actually sent a fair number of pictures of people's hearts to patients. And of course, if it's in the jar going home, it's not going to generate any data. This could be something.
There was one of the things with the studies of the mice,
mm-hmm.
and it was at the bottom, and it said somebody had done a study that heart failure correlates to people having AAA aneurysms.
It's the same gene.
Okay.
So there are some genes that affect heart function and structure only. And there are some that are a little more promiscuous, and they cause syndromes.
Okay.
That they affect, multiple. They cause deafness and lactic acidosis and heart failure. And then there are some that do neither of those two extremes. They sometimes cause one, and other times cause the other, but they don't necessarily cause it in a syndrome of the two going together. So there's a lot we don't know. In the case of the ones that cause heart failure only, or cardiomyopathy only, they're most often molecules that only live in the heart. So that makes sense. But for some of these ones that live in many tissues, how can they only cause disease in certain tissues? That's still kind of serious sometimes. Yeah.
I confess, first of all, that the biochemistry was several stories above my head, but it seems to me that you've discovered through this research that the contraction within those heart cells plays a major role in heart failure, and that there are a number of that the LVADs are productive in possibly healing that, that stem cells can be researched to develop procedures, and that you've provided a basis for pharmaceutical research.
Mm-hmm.
Now, whether it's governmental, academic, or corporate, do some of those researchers then have the ability to test some of their drugs on the T tissue that we have provided.
Yeah, I mean, if we write the right grants and get the right funding, and we have it periodic times over the years, get to test some new compounds in freshly isolated tissues. Again, with the usual caveats that, you know, still maintains patient confidentiality, that we still got consent from patients that they can be used for studies to be named later, rather than studies that were specified up front. If you're in a clinical trial, you've got to know about what the specific goals and risks of that clinical trial are. But these types of studies where there's no risk other than a breach of confidentiality, that's the thing we have to assure you that there'll be no breach. So yes, they do get to be used in some preclinical drug development or drug exploration studies.
Thank you.
Talking, I was, when I first started with Penn, I was a patient at Dr. Jessup's, and I know her involvement in heart research. She mentioned your name several times. The stem cell part of this, is this something that is pretty well advanced, or is it just getting started?
I think in a lot of ways it's just getting started. And I think if you had, I mean, there's been, right, it's been something that's been energized by plenty of funding and plenty of interest and patients willing to participate in clinical trials or preclinical, you know, research studies with donated tissues, as you have. But the heart is not an easy one to introduce stem cells into. I think there are other organs that are going to be suitable for regenerative strategies more than the heart. What's interesting is that that doesn't mean that, oh, there's nothing useful that can come with stem cells for the sake of heart failure, because what we can do is use them to make really cool models of disease that are have the right genetics that human beings have. So that's what these induced stem cells that we're making those tissues out of. So stem cells can help heart research by becoming replacement parts, but that's a long way off. Stem cells can help heart research by providing human muscle cells that we can study in a way that we know will be more relevant. That's not such a distant goal. That's ready to happen.
How much of a play does the government have in all this?
It's just a matter of funding, right? So right now, the has a role because right now the NIH budget's been flat for quite a while, and so it's competitive, and most of us who are successful have a balanced portfolio of some industry funding because we're doing translational things that pharmaceutical firms do care about, and we're doing some federally funded work as well.
Thank you.
I can remember 25 years ago, I was waiting for an endoscopy, and I was watching at Lourdes, and it was on Good Morning America, and they showed, it was a Harvard study, and they showed stem cells that had been made into, like, heart, it may be. What happened? It's 25 years.
So I'm saying, there have been plenty of research, plenty of clinical trials, but the signals of how much they're making an intact heart improving its function are very limited.
Because I remember when Henry was at Temple, the guys were all talking about they were growing hearts in pigs across the street.
Yeah. So I think your impression that it's either stalled or made very glacially slow progress in terms of being applicable to us.
Right.
It's right.
Okay.
And what?
I believe there's been some work with stem cells post angioplasty or post MI with improved outcomes. Are you aware of?
I am aware of it. So those mechanisms. There are, but they're small improvements. They're really not game changing. So if you measure a very sensitive thing, the MRIs and this and that, some of those trials have shown a signal of a few percent increase in ejection fraction in those getting the cells versus those who have it. But a few percent increase in ejection fraction doesn't really matter at the bedside.
Dr. Margolis, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great quotes on leadership and life.
Thank you so much
for taking your time today.
Thank you. I'm sorry I can't hang around with you folks. I really do have to go back to clinic. I just came. So take care.
Thank you.
Happy holidays.
Thank you. as John indicated, some of this stuff seems kind of over the head, but for those of you who are related to some of these trials, it's probably closer. And I also will warn you, now that you've been exposed to some of this, you're going to hear things on the radio or TV that relate to it, that all of a sudden you never heard before. It was there, but you never focused on it. So for example, just, I think it was yesterday in the news, for the first time they've actually been able to, inside the body, change parts of the DNA. In other words, he talked about a defective part of the DNA, and there are all sorts of ways of addressing that. Well, for the first time ever, they've actually somehow, I don't understand this part of it, but they've been able to extract and replace that one part of the DNA. We are in a very exciting age, even though it's been very slow, as you said, from 25 years ago. And so hopefully, whatever you take away from this, one is it's an excitement of progress, some insight what's going on behind the scenes. And I gotta tell you, one of the things that happened just recently, I was down in Washington at a conference, and I was the table leader for a discussion about education in transplant patients. And one of the big issues we identified was, there's a lot of resources out there, but they're not promoted in a way that we find them. And yet you're here today, exposed to something that most people don't even know exists. And I'm so pleased that you took your time today to come and see that. And many of you did because you knew the doctor, but others are exposed to something here that's going to widen your horizons. And so in the same vein, let me just quickly introduce a couple things. I've mentioned before another resource, and that is the Transplant Recipients International Organization, here in Philadelphia chapter, has written a book about transplantation for kids. So in other words, if you have grandchildren or children in the age of, I'm going to say, 5 to maybe 9 or 10, this would be a very nice resource to sit down. It's online on the TRIO website, and I'll show you that link in just a minute. But I also have some copies here. If you'd like one to take home to your children's family, so they understand a little bit more, or somebody, it's about not a child getting a transplant. It's about a child understanding what's happening in the family when somebody's getting a transplant. So please feel free to come on up and take one of these when we get through here. The other resource that I mentioned earlier, this has been recorded. It will be up on YouTube and part of the TRIO Transplant Presentation Library. And so that symbol is the opening slide for every one of these. We have at this point, this will be number 90 of programs we've recorded since about we started recording about 2009, so about 8 years now. And so this will be up there, as well as a more recent one we just did, where we had a panel of 6 donor families sharing their experience with receiving communication from their recipients. Fascinating. We recorded that, and in the beginning of that panel, Howard Nathan, who some of you know, who's the CEO of the Gift of Life Donor Program, which is a program responsible in this region for educating people about organ donation and coordinating the donation from a donor family, okay, that results in us getting our hearts, for example. And so he wandered into the meeting in the beginning, as he often does, and we ended up asking some questions. And so that recording ended up being 3 recordings, and the first one, 89A, is his talking about how the Gift of Life supports and promotes communication with your donors, sometimes even to the point of meeting. A very small percentage ever do meet, but it's an interesting sharing. And then the other two, 89B and 89C, are the members of the panel sharing their stories and experience of what it was like to get and sometimes meet their recipients. So if you're looking for some encouragement, if you haven't already done that, thank you, especially at Thanksgiving time or the anniversary of your transplant, to write that donor family just to say even thanks. That would be an important one out in this library. The trioweb.org is the name of the website. And if you go there, under the menu item resources, you'll find Transplant Presentation Library. And so that's right there. We are in the process of taking the first 65 of those programs converted from the DVDs we sent out to chapters into YouTube versions. And so we've got a dozen of those done in the past week. Probably going to take us about 2 months to finish getting all those up there. By the time we're through, those 65 plus 66 through 89C and now 90 are already up there. We'll have that whole library available to you and anybody else. You want to email something, you know, the link to it to somebody in the other part of the country, that would work out just fine. The other very important program that we're still very committed to, and some of you have seen some of this, but I'll put it out as a reminder, and that is a focus on reminding people who have had transplants that you are at high risk for cancers. Cancers can kill you. You don't want to die from cancer after all you've been through, okay? And so our education program is built around a website of information that's focused on learning about the risk of different types of cancers by your organ type. So for example, up in the blue left corner, you see heart, there's a page there talking about the risk for heart patients as opposed to other type of organs, liver, lungs, kidneys, etc. Once you understand and are concerned, and this is meant to be video-based and it's still under development, about halfway done. It's probably going to take 2 more years to finish it out. These are videos, and you'll recognize some of the doctors who have interviewed and shared, either through their presentations or one-on-one interviews, their insights into that particular type of cancer. And so, secondly, once you understand your risk, well, what are you going to look for? What are the symptoms you should be paying attention to? And our program is very good in terms of reminding you to get that skin checkup, to have those types of things we do, colonoscopies, et cetera, et cetera. That eye checkup, the feet, you know, all these kinds of things that relate sometimes to the diabetes that comes often with our medication. We're a very complex patient. And so by paying attention to this, you'll know what to look for. And then finally, how do you live with cancer? Preventing it is part of living with it, all right? Doing things that keep you out of the sun, as an easy example, but many others. And so getting it diagnosed, getting it treated, and long-term recovery are part of the red banner there. And then the bottom part is all extra resources, such as patient testimonials. You'll recognize some of the people here, for example, who have sat down and in 3 to 5 minutes shared their experience of post-transplant cancers and sharing how they have recovered from that and are living with it. And so this was meant to be a real good map of the whole thing, and everybody said, well, it's too complex, Nick, we won't be able to figure out how to use that. And so we converted it into this. It's the exact same website, only it's meant to be, there's the learn, look, live, and link. And under that, we're right when I'm looking at the resources one, the link, and you see you have links down below to go to that. And so that's out there, and I would recommend that you visit it. And again, just go to trioweb.org, and there's a link to take you to the cancer website, which is trioweb, post-transplant cancer, PTC.org. And so we summarize with our daily challenge, right? We don't defeat death with transplant. You get an extension of life. And then your challenge is, what are you going to do with that? So it becomes, what are we going to do with the days, months, and hopefully years of extended life? And you've heard the years here. And I got to tell you, there's so many wonderful stories about what people are doing with that gift that they were given with their lives today. And so this is the same question that even if you haven't had a transplant, you still face every day. What are you going to do with your life today? And so the inspiration that makes me move every day is, I want to live until I die. And isn't that what it's all about?
Yeah.
Living your life to the fullest. I don't care what pain you have, what other ancillary thing you run into. And I got to share with you, recently, Horizon Blue Cross pays you for certain preventative stuff. And one of that is to have a nurse come to your house and sit down and go over your whole health program and make recommendations. I always look forward to that. And so I had one just recently. And by the way, they paid me $40 to have her come do this. They paid me $40 for her to come do this. You got that?
They should call Edna.
Huh?
They should call Edna.
Okay. Anyway, that happened to be the third thing I got from them. So I had an eye exam post-diabetic, and that was worth $25. $15 for doing a PSA. And so, I'm sorry, an A1C for sugar level. That's another $15. plus this 40, that's 80. And most recently, I just had a DEXA scan done, which is a bone scan. That was worth 50. They paid me 130 in the past month and a half. But my point is that she came, and we sat down at the dinner table, went over everything, and I showed her all my charts and, you know, what meds you're taking, all that kind of stuff, right? We got all through. She said, do you have any questions for me? I said, yes, I do have one question for you. How many times have you gotten those surveys about something health-related? And the last question is always the same. How would you describe your health? Excellent, good, fair, or poor? I always felt guilty because I felt just great. But how can you say you're excellent when you have a heart transplant, prostate cancer, kidney cancer, diabetes, you name it? I mean, it seems like you're lying. So I said to her, how do I answer that now that you know my history? She said, Mr. Gleason, you're doing excellent. She said, you should check off excellent. So for those of you who asked me earlier, how are you doing, Jim? I'm excellent, and I have the numbers to prove it. We recently had two MRIs, all preemptive type stuff. We had a full body scan. We had a bone scan. We had a chest x-ray. We had the annual stress test here. Everything came back great. So at the age of 74, I'm celebrating life every day. I am thankful for a donor who was very athletic, which I never was. His heart is beating with those kind of cells we've got here. And life is really good. And I hope yours is the same. And that you can say the same thing when you take that survey, okay? And so, I wanted to thank Dr. Margolis, and I just assumed you might be leaving this.
Margolis,
thank you. I've got two pronunciations. I asked him what it was, and I told him to heckle me if I used the wrong one, Margolis. But I also want to recognize our social team, Deb Gordon, Sally Smith, Courtney Summer, and Rachel Smith Schendler. Anyway, welcome, and we thank you for what you do. And over our Thanksgiving dinners, we will include you in our prayer of thanks. Remember, the holiday party, December 11th, and then in the springtime, Friday, March 16th, Dr. Goldberg is going to be talking about beyond year two, post-transplant, looking into the future. I really have to talk to him, see what he thinks he's going to talk about, and how that might relate to the experiences that you could share of how to live long term with that heart transplant. Everybody, thank you for coming out. Thank you for Dr. Moe. Thank you so much.